Our next speaker is Kathy Wang from University of Oregon. Kathy?
All right. Hopefully everybody can see and hear things. Move that over. All right. So first, I really want to thank Sugi and Chris for putting together a really great series of workshops over the last couple of months. So it's really an honor to also be able to contribute. So today I want to tell you all a story about how we can use transient absorption spectroscopy to actually measure materials in situ during formation to kind of actually learn something about the materials formation process. And so today I want to focus on a story about the formation of lead halide perovskite nanocrystals. So probably everybody's heard at least a little bit about these materials at this point. They've kind of become very popular over the past few years because they exhibit these quite remarkable photophysical properties. Chief among them probably is that they can have very high photoluminescence quantum yields, and yet they're really easy to synthesize. So I'm definitely not a synthetic chemist, but even I can somehow manage to make these nanocrystals. So because of these properties, people envision them for use in things like energy efficient lighting or photovoltaics and other types of electronics. And so, you know, for these types of applications, people really care about the photophysics. So people have measured the photophysics of these materials quite a lot already. However, when people do measure these materials spectroscopically, typically they're only measuring nanocrystals that are, you know, fully grown, they're well capped by a shell, usually of organic ligands, and they're really stable, right? Because they can survive a measurement. And so because of that, we don't actually really know what's going on during the synthesis, how the photophysics change. And so, for example, that's what I'm trying to show in this photograph here. Each of these four vials contain a sample of these nanocrystals at various stages during growth. But for the most part, we only know what's happening in that final vial of fully grown nanocrystals. We don't know what's going on during the synthesis. So what I wanted to do is see if we can actually use excitons to learn something about how it is that nanocrystals actually grow. All right, so that's going to be the focus of my talk. So what do people already know about nanocrystal growth? So the main mechanism of growth that people typically cite is actually from Lemaire back in the 1950s. And that's of this kind of burst nucleation mechanism. So the idea is that your nanocrystal is made out of, you know, a number of precursors. And so during growth or during a synthesis, first your precursor concentration increases until it reaches some minimum nucleation threshold. And beyond that threshold, you start to form nuclei. But the process of forming nuclei depletes your concentration of precursors. You drop below the threshold, and then your stage of nucleation is over. So this is like a burst of nucleation. And then after that, each of those nuclei then just continue to grow, and your precursor concentration continues to drop. And so people have shown, you know, things have been added to this mechanism, but this is sort of like the main concept that's been shown to work for a lot of different types of nanoparticles. However, this doesn't really say anything about the nanocrystal surface. All right, let me use my laser pointer. It doesn't really say anything about the nanocrystal surface. And of course, nanocrystals, the surface is of great importance, right? Because they have this really high surface to volume ratio. So that can affect the eventual photophysical properties of the nanocrystal. And it can also affect how it is the nanocrystals grow in the first place. So here I'm showing two different cartoon illustrations of what that surface might look like. So for example, you could form nuclei, they could become well-capped pretty early on in the reaction, and then they could continue to slowly grow while they're fairly well-capped with these organic ligands. On the other hand, you could have these nuclei be pretty much uncapped during the whole growth process, and then become capped at the end in some sort of terminal ligation stage, okay? And now you need these ligands because they're the things that make your nanocrystal stable. They prevent nanocrystals from aggregating together. They prevent them from, you know, falling apart or continuing to grow. So it's really important to understand what that surface looks like. However, nanocrystal surfaces are kind of pretty notoriously difficult to measure using other techniques. So I'm hoping that spectroscopy can actually tell us something about this. All right, so first let me talk a little bit about the synthesis that we're using, just so you have a picture of what's going on here. So we're using something called a solvation limited synthesis, which means that the precursors that we use, they're going to be insoluble in the nonpolar solvent that I put them in, hexane. So they're mostly just sitting around as big solid chunks. And then I add a little bit of my organic ligand. And that's essentially going to solubilize some of this precursor, bring it into solution, and allowing it to react. So now it can, you know, increase that concentration of precursor and form those nanocrystals. Now, usually to halt a nanocrystal reaction, you would take this whole reaction volume and put it in a centrifuge and spin it around and pull out all of the solid precursor so you can't react it anymore. However, you know, turning on a centrifuge, having it spin up and then slow down again, that can take a few minutes. And so because of that, that's, you know, that's not anywhere near an in situ measurement anymore, right? Because those reactants can keep on reacting, or the nanocrystals could be degrading or something like that. So instead, we take a little aliquot of the reaction solution, we just press it through a syringe filter directly into the cuvette where we measure it. And so that's as close to an in situ measurement as we can get. Now, when we do that, this is the sort of absorption and fluorescence data that we acquire. So you can see that as a function of the reaction time, you can see the growth of some features like this one here, and then sometimes those features can decay, you form this sort of long red tail. And similar in the fluorescence, you can see the growth of a feature here on the blue edge of the fluorescent spectrum, which even after just 20 minutes will start to decay. The whole spectrum kind of moves to the red and grows in intensity. And this kind of data we collected using these Teflon syringe filters. And we were surprised when we found that when we changed the medium inside our filter, that we actually get pretty different results. So this is that same reaction, but now we're using nylon filters. And you can see those two features I was pointing out here and here, they actually don't appear in these spectra at all. So what does that mean? Like, does that tell us anything? So our hypothesis is that Teflon, famously, doesn't really stick to anything. It's a nonpolar material. And so we think that inside our reaction volume, we actually have, you know, a distribution of different types of nanocrystals. Some of them are going to be more well capped than others. And so we think that nanocrystals of any variety are going to be able to make it through this filter. However, a polar nylon filter, we think, is only going to let through these well capped nanocrystals with a shell of organic ligand around them. And allowing them to sort of slip through this polar nylon filter. If you have a poorly capped nanocrystal, it's still going to have some of these polar surfaces exposed. And so it's probably going to adhere to that filter. So essentially what I'm saying is I think that early on in the reaction, these features that we see in the Teflon filtered samples, but not in the nylon, those features probably come from poorly capped nanocrystals. So we're already starting to refine our picture slightly of what we think is going on at these surfaces. We think that at the beginning, we have poorly capped nanocrystals, and it's only at the end that we see these well-capped nanocrystals that can survive passing through this nylon filter. All right, so if we just look at the fluorescent spectra, right, that we collected passing through Teflon and nylon, okay, and we see the differences in these features, if we just integrate under these fluorescence curves, and plot that integrated intensity as a function of reaction time, then we see two growth curves that look like this. So there definitely appear to be different stages of growth, right? So within the first 20 minutes, you can see the Teflon filtered sample, it grows in intensity pretty rapidly and fairly linearly until you hit this point where suddenly it's still growing, your intensity continues to grow, but at a much slower rate. And at the same time, our nylon filtered samples initially don't fluoresce at all. Right? And so we think this is because initially these are poorly capped nanocrystals that can't survive that filtration process. And that at some point they have enough organic ligand on them to protect them. And then you're going to see that fluorescent intensity grow up. Right? So this is starting to paint a picture for us of what is going on. Now, another thing to consider before we turn to time resolve measurements is that these measurements also show us that young nanocrystals are really unstable. All right, so if we take some of our reaction volume after only 15 minutes of growth, and we filter that into our cuvette and immediately start measuring the fluorescence, we measure that fluorescence for a few hours, you can see that the fluorescence spectrum actually is changing. It might be hard to tell just because of the line width here. So here I'm plotting the normalized change in fluorescence. And you can see that over here on the blue edge of the spectrum, our fluorescence is actually going down by 80% or so. So these are small nanocrystals that are dying, either they're falling apart, most of them are probably falling apart, and some small amount of them might actually be growing slightly in size, generating more fluorescence here. And you can see the same thing after 35 minutes of growth, even though now the spectra doesn't change quite as much. And then by the time you have 2 hours of growth, then now suddenly your nanocrystals become significantly more stable. However, For all of these though, you can tell that you're gonna have to do your measurement really quickly, because after just 6 minutes, those nanocrystals clearly have changed, right? So measuring this sample of nanocrystals after 6 minutes, you're not really observing these, you know, what's actually happening in that reaction vial. So we need some way to measure these samples very quickly. And so if I want to use time resolve measurements to learn about this, usually what we would do is try to do transient absorption spectroscopy. However, the problem is that transient absorption spectroscopy typically takes a long time, or a relatively long time. So if we want to measure the change in absorption or transmission as a function of a pump probe delay time, usually you perform this measurement serially. And so you would, for each one of these time delays, you would need a different laser shot. And for each laser shot, you have a different delay between a pump pulse and a probe pulse. And you change that delay by, typically you have some sort of retroreflecting mirror on your laser table that you move back and forth in one arm of this interferometer. And so doing all of this takes a long time. So this measurement typically takes anywhere from like a few minutes to a few hours. And so I showed you on that last slide, that's not gonna work for measuring these young samples of nanocrystals, because they change after only a minute or so. So the way that we're trying to get around that is doing single shot transient absorption spectroscopy. So if I have my pump pulse, I sort of blow it up so it's larger in size. Okay, I focus it down into a line on the sample, and I overlap it with a probe pulse, also focused down to a line, but it's instant normal to the sample. All right, so you can see I've spatially encoded my time delay. So there's a much larger time delay here than there would be here. Right. And so I've essentially parallelized this measurement. If I take my probe pulse and I focus it, or I image it onto an array detector. So now I get this entire pump probe time delay in one shot. And that allows our measurement to go a lot faster. All right, so the actual instrument that I'm using looks something like this. I don't have time to actually go through all the details of the instrument, but definitely feel free to ask me more about it afterwards. But the main idea here is that we have our pump and probe lines, we have cylindrical lenses, focus them down into overlapped lines on their sample. You can see the tilt in the beams right there. Our sample in this case is a cuvette, a flow cell cuvette with septa on one side. And so we can just inject our sample right into the cuvette. And then this line, the probe is imaged onto the slit of a spectrograph. So then along the long axis of the slit, you have our pump probe delay time, and then inside the spectrograph, we can disperse the light. So now our camera is going to collect this two-dimensional data of pump probe time delay on one axis and our wavelength resolution on the other. And so you can collect all of that in one shot. Now I say one shot, we call it single shot transient absorption because you can collect that whole transient in one shot. But usually we use more than one shot to get better signal to noise. And how long does that take? It depends a lot on your sample, of course, like how you know, what your optical density is, how much response your sample has, that kind of thing. But it can be anywhere from a few seconds to even less than a second for some stronger samples that you can collect this data. All right, so that's perfect. So now we can actually measure our young nanocrystal samples to see what's going on. All right, so these are the types of single shot transient absorption spectra that we get. These are the line shapes at a number of different times during our nanocrystal synthesis. So the first one I'll direct your attention to is this one here after 2 hours of synthesis. And this is essentially the type of spectrum and the type of line shape that you commonly see reported for these kinds of nanocrystals in literature, because these are stable, well-capped nanocrystals, and that's what people usually measure. However, in our younger nanocrystals, you can see that there are definitely some interesting line shapes that don't exist in the fully formed nanocrystals. So we see these, if we take a slice here, these sort of oscillatory line shapes. So when we saw this, we immediately thought that this looks a lot like the type of line shapes that have been reported in literature for electroabsorption measurements. So absorption measurements where that take place in an external electric field. So why do we see oscillatory components in that kind of spectroscopy? So there are two primary reasons. One is that resonance that you see without the electric field, upon the application of that field, that could shift one way or another. So in this case, a redshift. And so the differential optical density that you see would be the purple curve minus the black curve, which looks like the first derivative of that linear absorption spectrum, right? Now, how would we see that in this type of sample? So If we have a nanocrystal, the pump would generate an exciton within the nanocrystal. And if I have some uncapped surface on the nanocrystal, then one of the carriers could get trapped there, creating an electric field across that nanocrystal. And so now when the probe comes along, it's going to report the absorption spectrum of this nanocrystal with an electric field. Okay, so that's how this kind of line shape, first derivative line shape, could happen. You could also have the electric field causing a broadening of your transition. Okay, and that's going to cause your differential absorption to be the purple minus the black, which is a second derivative line shape compared to your linear absorption. And in our sample, we could expect to see that because, you know, these are just nanocrystals in solution, they're randomly oriented. If you have bare patches on the nanocrystal, they'll be in random locations. And so the pump could generate a collection of randomly oriented electric fields. And so now if you try to probe the sample with linearly polarized light, each one of those transitions will be affected differently because the orientation of the electric field is different, right? So we could expect to see both of these first derivative and second derivative contributions. So we try to fit these line shapes to the first and second derivatives of our absorption. So here's our expression. We have our linear absorption spectrum. We're going to take a derivative with respect to wavelength. So for these three reaction time points that I'm mentioning, in color here is our linear absorption. Here's our first derivative shown in black. And remember, this is the absorption redshift. We could also see the second derivative, which remember is line shape broadening. Okay, and so here for those three time points, again, our linear absorption is here. Our second derivative is now shown in black. And the third component I'm actually going to add is just the transient absorption line shape from the end of our reaction, because we're going to assume that that is the transient absorption signal that comes from well-capped nanocrystals. All right, so we're assuming that as the nanocrystal synthesis progresses, we're going to get an increased amount of well-capped nanocrystal signal, which we know looks something like this. All right, so we put these weighting factors in front of these three components, so it's a very simple fit. And when we do that, we find that we can fit our transient absorption line shapes quite well. So here our dashed line here is our line shape, and the black is our fit. And so here I'm showing these three particular time points that I was emphasizing, but we can do this throughout the entire reaction. And we can see that the contribution to line shape from Stark-induced absorption redshift, you can see it sort of linearly decreases as the reaction progresses. The Stark-induced broadening, it decreases quite rapidly, but then it actually shows a peak before it decreases again. And then our transient absorption signal from well-capped nanocrystals, you can see that increasing as the reaction continues. So this again supports this picture that we have now of during a nanocrystal reaction, the nuclei initially being very poorly capped with ligand. It remains poorly capped for a while, but then it slowly starts to become capped as a function of time. And you can see actually quantify that happening here. Now, what's going on with this peak here? How come you get this peak in the broadening? What could be causing that? So the next couple slides I'll show you are still unpublished, sort of more preliminary data, but we think we have an idea of what's going on. So this peak in broadening, we think is happening because of this process called Ostwald ripening. Okay, and that's, so you know, any ensemble of nanocrystals, you're gonna have some that are a little bit larger and better capped and more stable than others. And so at some point during the reaction, you've kind of consumed all of your precursor. And at that point, sometimes these less stable nanocrystals will start to fall apart back into precursor, and those precursors eventually get eaten up by our larger, more stable nanocrystals. It's kind of like survival of the fittest nanocrystal, I guess. And so you can see in the middle of this process, you actually have much larger distribution of both sizes and passivation states or capping states during the middle of this process, more heterogeneous than either the beginning or the end. So we can kind of see some signatures of that in some of these spectra. So for example, here, like remember that derivative line shape, I think, is coming from uncapped nanocrystals. And so as the reaction proceeds from red to purple here, you can see that derivative line shape actually shift. It grows and shifts to the blue, which is really unusual that any feature would do that during a nanocrystal growth, right? Usually everything's shifting to the red because everything's getting larger, but we actually see it shift to the blue, and we think that that's because of this Ostwald ripening. Now you can see that that's much more clear here in this reaction than in this reaction. And so we see this signature more or less depending on the reaction parameters that we use. And so we think that the quality and nature of the surface is dictating how much of this Ostwald ripening process occurs. And now we have a mechanism of actually seeing that. So we're almost out of time, but let me show you just one more thing. And that's about changing ligand ratios. That's another way that we can observe some differences as well. So I didn't actually mention which ligands I was using. This is octylamine and oleic acid, which are two pretty common ligands for this kind of reaction. And so we can see if we change, like we keep the same total amount of ligand, but we change the ratio of those two ligands. And you can see a distinct change in sort of the process of nanocrystal growth just here in the fluorescent spectra. And you can see also differences in the quality of the surface based on sort of the size of these features, as well as here you can see there's not much of a blue shift as a function of growth time. But in this example, you can see that that peak does blue shift as the nanocrystals continue to grow, indicating that we probably have some sort of Ostwald ripening or a more distinct Ostwald ripening process happening in the second example. All right, so in conclusion, we've seen that the photophysics of lead halide perovskites evolves during their synthesis. We can use tilted pulses to spatially encode a time delay for transient absorption spectroscopy, allowing us to do that measurement in just a few seconds. And that's useful because our nanocrystals are pretty unstable when they're young. But when we can measure them, we find these unique line shapes that we show are caused by surface trapped carriers, allowing us to report on the surface of nanocrystals during their synthesis, which is actually a pretty hard thing to do with any other type of technique. All right, so I should acknowledge the people who did this work. In particular, James Sadegan really drove this project and did all the work with the nanocrystals. And my former grad student, Dr. Kelly Wilson, who designed our instrument and did all of the work on that. Thank these nice people for funding and you for your attention. Thanks.
Right, awesome. Okay, we'll just jump right into questions, because they're here. In fact, I got to. So first question from Bluebell Drummond. Kathy, are you happy with the flow cuvette transient absorption reproducibility resolution? Or do you think using a flow reactor would improve things?
The flow cuvette, I mean, it's been working well for us so far, I guess. I've thought about hooking up some kind of flow reactor. I just haven't yet, I guess. But that would probably make things more reproducible. One thing that we found, and this is again, just more of a preliminary observation, I don't have enough data to really prove it, is that the reaction actually depends a lot on how much polar surface is available to the reactant. So basically if I take my reaction, I dump a bunch of glass beads in it, the reaction will proceed differently. And I think that's because of heterogeneous nucleation. And so I kind of worry about changing the reaction in such a way that I'm really changing the surface area for the reactant during the reaction. But I haven't actually tried it. And so that effect that I talked about, it won't happen if I put a bunch of like Teflon beads in my sample, for example, because that's not polar. And so there's the possibility of somehow trying to rig up some sort of flow cell reactor that doesn't involve polar surfaces like glass. Anyway, so I have thought about it. I haven't done it yet because it sounds really hard, but it could be a really good idea and would solve some of our problems. So yeah, that's a good suggestion.
Okay, good enough. And then along those same lines from Justin, what about temperature control during the experiment?
Yeah, so the whole reaction actually takes place, instead of using a stir bar, we sit it inside a sonicator bath. And so the sonicator bath we keep at a particular temperature. So that's how we can actually, I think a couple slides ago, we can actually control the temperature of the reaction just by having the whole thing sit in a bath. So yeah, and that does seem to change our reaction significantly. So that's a knob that we're planning to turn.
Okay, a question about the experiment itself. What are the limits on the time window? So how long can you go in the time resolution and also the spectral window and the spectral resolution?
Good question. So our time window right now, is this worth going back? Maybe, okay. Our time window right now is limited to about 60 picoseconds. in one shot. Of course, you can double that if you do choose to move a retroreflector in one arm. You can go to, you know, obviously 120 picoseconds in two shots if you want to. That's actually pretty decently long for an instrument of this nature. And that's the main way that we can get that is actually using this SLM to flatten out our excitation field. So it's pretty even throughout that line. Okay, so that was time range. Time resolution, our time resolution here, I think is about 100 femtoseconds or so. Our laser is a little bit shorter than that, but at some point you're limited by the thickness of this cuvette. The thickness of the cuvette will sort of smear out your time points. And so we try to use, I think right now we're using a 200 micron cuvette because we don't want to smear out our time resolution that much. Okay, so there's that. Wavelength resolution, or wavelength resolution, or not resolution, but wavelength range is currently about 100 nanometers. We can get larger than that, but then it slows down our detection by a little bit because there are more pixels that we have to collect. So we're really collecting at the limit of our data transfer rates, essentially. So yeah, so hopefully that answers that question. I hope I hit everything there.
There was the resolution too. Wavelength resolution was
low. Oh, wavelength resolution. Right, okay. Wavelength resolution, we are at, I think, 2 pixels per nanometer, I want to say. Yeah, I think that's where we're at. I can look that up and try to recalculate that in a second. But in that range, yeah.
Okay, that sounds pretty good. So here's a question from Milan Delora, which is also a question I had, which is, do you get any additional information? You're showing all these transient absorption line shapes, but what about the dynamics? Do you get any additional information from the, you know, the time resolved part of the transient absorption?
Good question. So we haven't looked that deeply into it yet, but we have noticed now that we're doing a number of reactions with different conditions that in some conditions, those dynamics actually do look different. We haven't figured out an interpretation for that yet, but the, so highly preliminary, just mostly guesswork from looking at some data right now is that in nanocrystal samples where we believe the nanocrystals are very poorly passivated, the decay dynamics are significantly faster. I guess that kind of makes sense because it's probably more probable that you're gonna trap your exciton. And so maybe that's why we see the decay happen faster. But I haven't really looked into it as much as I should have yet. So remains to be seen more conclusively.
Okay, well, I did not quote the second part of Milan's question, which was a suggestion for one mechanism, which was spectral diffusion for the Stark-induced broadening at early times. So it's in the chat, so you can take a look at that. Sure. Probably one of the last questions, based on the sign of the linear Stark shift, can you identify which carrier is trapping to the surface?
I don't know yet. I haven't looked at that yet. I'm not sure that you, well, there've been actually some conflicting reports in the perovskite literature about whether you should be expecting redshifts or blue shifts from external, I think it was external electric fields that they were looking at. So it seems like there's some subtlety there actually. So I don't know yet, but there actually could be something to be said there. So that's a good point, but I don't have an answer right now.
Okay, so this is related to a follow-up question, which was also basically comparing the Stark shift in the perovskites to the early work on cadmium selenide, which was an external compensation of built-in fields. Could there be something analogous to what you observe in the dots that they're healing from their initially charge-prone condition through the synthesis?
If they're healing from their initially charge-prone condition during the synthesis, let's see.
Through the synthesis. They're basically charging through the synthesis or at least prone to undergo photoinduced charging from the synthesis. I'm trying to sort of condense the question.
Okay.
I might be doing an accurate job.
It's to talk about the blue shifting that you're seeing. I think it's so interesting.
Okay. Let me make sure I understand. I know we're probably.
Thank you, Mark.
Okay. So you're saying the blue shifting of the derivative feature? Is that the blue shifting we're talking about? So if it is.
Your second last slide.
Okay. Yeah. So the blue shifting of the derivative feature. Here. Yeah.
Okay. We'll have to do this pretty quickly to get Sean.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah. So Could it be, actually, we should probably discuss this if we don't have that much time. So right now, my current interpretation is this Oswald ripening situation. We're trying to measure, find a way to measure size at the same time, which I think will give us a lot more quantitative information. Like we could turn these parameters that I have into actual parameters for like change in polarization or change in dipole moment. And that will tell us a lot more about whether or not this hypothesis is actually correct. And so we think that the synthesis is healing the stronger half of the distribution, that it's sort of making them grow stronger, essentially. I don't know if I answered your question properly, but we can talk offline because I don't want to steal Sean's time.